might of the enemy must very soon be turned on us. Hitler knows that he will have to break us in this island or lose the war. If we can stand up to him, all Europe may be free, and the life of the world may move forward into broad, sunlit uplands.
I rate him as the greatest war leader in British history.
Well, I think it has to be the inspiration that he brought to the whole country and to the whole war effort.
He was a figure larger than life, and he had the capacity to make other people see things through his vision.
He knew that he had this fantastic challenge, and you sense that he felt a sort of elation about this. And the energy was unbelievable.
We have before us an ordeal of the most grievous kind. We have before us many, many long months of struggle and of suffering.
He got contact with the common man and expressed the common man's thoughts. He had a very engaging simplicity and also a sympathy, which seemed to go out to an audience. You could see the audience being attracted, enormously attracted to him as a man.
The British nation is stirred and moved as it never has been at any time in its long, eventful, famous history. And it is no hackneyed trope of speech to say that they mean to conquer or to die.
Churchill, at his best, in other words, during the war, was a man of towering greatness and an enormously impressive leader. But if you go back to pre-war years, he was not a great man politically. The British public really didn't trust him. He wasn't reliable.
We regarded him then as a has-been. A great warrior, a great politician, a great fighter, a great imperialist, not at all modern in his outlook, a great reactionary.
He was a man who needed his moment, really, to fulfill himself. In his history, he had a catalogue of quite near disastrous mistakes and political misjudgments and military misjudgments. But with his strong views, when they coincided with our national needs and interests, then there was a strength that he could throw in to the country's struggle.
We shall fight on the beaches, we shall fight on the landing grounds, we shall fight in the fields and in the streets, we shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender.
This is your victory. Victory of the cause of freedom.
On the 8th of May 1945, after 5 years of war, Winston Churchill celebrated victory in Europe with king and people. Before 1940, many had written him off as a failure. By 1945, he was called the savior of Western civilization. Churchill was born into the privileged world of the British aristocracy. His father, Lord Randolph Churchill, was the youngest son of the Duke of Marlborough. His mother, Jenny Jerome, was the lively daughter of an American financier.
When his mother, Lady Randolph Churchill, was 7.5 months pregnant, she was staying here at Blenheim Palace. One day she joined the shooting party. While out with the shooters, she had a fall, and labour pains came on. She was rushed back to the palace, over the rough ground in a pony trap. So it was that Winston Churchill spent the first of his 90 Christmases here at Blenheim Palace. Here, too, he was baptised in the palace chapel shortly after Christmas of 1874. Winston Leonard Spencer Churchill.
Churchill's childhood followed the pattern of an upper-class British family. He was brought up by a nanny, and when he was 7, his mother sent him to boarding school. At 13, he went to Harrow. At Harrow, Churchill showed promise in the subjects he loved, history and English among them. He excelled in fencing, winning the public school's championship. In later life, he would joke about his lack of success at exams.
As life unfolded, I have been astonished to find how many more degrees I have received than I passed examinations.
Churchill was a lonely schoolboy. His parents were often too busy with their social life to bother with their son.
If you have not time to write, you might telegraph. That takes very little time. Please, darling mummy, do write to your loving son. Darling mummy, do attend to my letter. I am so wretched. Even now I weep. Please, my darling mummy, be kind to your loving son. Please, do come to your loving son, Winston S. Churchill.
Even on speech day, Churchill's parents failed to come see him. He missed their love. Instead, he poured out his troubles to his beloved nanny, Mrs. Everest. He called her womany. When she came to see him in her nanny's clothes, young Winston proudly showed her round the school, braving the comments of his schoolmates.
I remember once at the end of long summer holidays, I think I was 16 or 17, I was going back to Eton. And the last night we sat up late talking in his study at Chartwell, and we talked of many things, I think till 1 or 1:30 in the morning. And he said, "You know, dear boy, I think I've talked to you more these holidays than my father talked to me in the whole of his life." And there was no bitterness in it, but there was sadness.
After Harrow, Churchill applied for Sandhurst to train as a soldier. When, after the third attempt, he finally succeeded, his father, in the last stages of the syphilis that was to kill him, warned his son,
"I am certain that if you cannot prevent yourself from leading the idle, useless, unprofitable life you have had during your school days, you will become a mere social wastrel, one of the hundreds of public school failures, and you will degenerate into a shabby and futile existence."
When he got to Sandhurst, he found that his physique was a great disadvantage. He wrote to his mother and said, "I am cursed with so feeble a body." And indeed, he was only 5'6", and he was only 31 inches round the chest. He was hairless, and he felt very inferior physically, I think.
Churchill spent the next 4 years as a regular soldier, fighting in India and the Sudan. He called this period the university of his life. He read, wrote newspaper articles, and at 23 published his first book, a graphic account of the war on the Northwest frontier. In 1899, Churchill's search for action and adventure took him to South Africa to report on the Boer War. His articles warned the British public that in their fight for independence, the Boers were a formidable force, masters of the art of surprise. He was soon to experience this for himself.
On the 15th of November 1899, an armoured train with 150 British soldiers on board set off on patrol along this railway line. Churchill had been invited to join them. At first he'd been reluctant to do so, thinking that it would be a routine patrol with nothing new to report. But the commanding officer had persuaded him to go. It was to be one of the most fateful days of Churchill's life.
Break! The armoured train was ambushed and derailed by the Boers. During the attack that followed, Churchill took command, clearing the line so that the engine, with him on board, got away, taking 60 men, many of them wounded, to safety. Churchill returned to help the troops still fighting on the line, but was captured before he could reach them. He was taken prisoner, despite his protest that he was a war correspondent and not a soldier. When the press wrote about his exploits, he became an immediate hero. He was held prisoner in this building in Pretoria.
I hated every minute of my captivity more than I have hated any other period in my whole life. Great events were in progress. Fine opportunities for action and adventure were slipping away.
After 3 weeks in captivity, Churchill escaped over the prison wall and jumped a train. Young man, fair-haired, moustache, with a lisp, the description went out. Wanted, dead or alive. He hid in a mine, surrounded by Boer forces, and finally escaped again by train. The newspapers speculated on his whereabouts. Eventually he appeared in Durban. Here he told an enthusiastic crowd of his daring exploits. An article, How I Escaped from the Boers, promptly followed, then a book. In the autumn of 1900, with the war over, Churchill presented himself for election as the Conservative candidate for Oldham. The 26-year-old hero won by a narrow majority, helped by his mother.
She was proud, and she saw his name in the papers, and well-known people praised what he was doing, and so naturally she took a great maternal pride, and she got on the bandwagon in a big way and did a great deal to help him. As he says of her, she left no string unpulled, she left no cutlet uncooked, that would assist him in his career.
Churchill soon emerged as a rising star of the Tory party.
Somewhat heavy-looking, ambitious, hard-working, with a touch of mysticism that attracts the mob, a born orator with power to move people as he wills, Winston Spencer Churchill must go far.
But to Churchill's agile mind, his fellow Tories were, as he told his mother, sleepy, exhausted and played out. He attacked government policy, particularly on trade. The Tories wanted to tax goods imported from outside the empire. He wanted free trade. In 1904, now hated by the Tories, he joined the Liberals.
He was regarded as a renegade and a turncoat by a great body of political opinion. Also, at that time, my father was regarded as being fairly sort of bumptious and insufferable.
He was not really a party man, and indeed he had a certain contempt for all political parties. I remember him saying, you need a charger to carry you into battle, and you must take the most convenient hack in the stable and point it the direction you want it to go.
The charger Churchill took from the stable was the Liberal Party of Mr. Asquith. At the age of 30, he was appointed Under-Secretary for the Colonies, his first ministerial post. 3 years later, aged 33, he became one of the youngest cabinet ministers ever. As president of the Board of Trade, he introduced many social reforms. He abolished sweated labour, set up labour exchanges for the unemployed, legislated for a minimum wage, with compulsory meal breaks at work. The British owe their tea breaks to Churchill, but he was more successful at politics than love.
The great loves of his life, until he met my mother, were first of all Pamela Lytton, then there was Muriel Wilson, later became Mrs. Ward. She was a tremendous beauty, and he did propose to her. Then, of course, he was very much in love at one time with Ethel Barrymore, and he proposed to her.
But she refused him too. As an actress, she was not amused by the world of politics. Soon he was to meet a young woman who was interested in his political world, the daughter of an impoverished but aristocratic Liberal family, Clementine Hosier. Their first meeting was not a success.
My mother told me that she felt extremely uncomfortable with this man just standing there gazing at her. And he didn't say anything, and she didn't say anything. So
She saw standing not far away a bow of hers. So she sort of made a little sign. And the man came up and said, will you dance with me? So she took her exit very quickly and thankfully. And as the bow swept her off, he said to her, whatever were you doing talking to that frightful cad, Winston Churchill?
Churchill, cabinet minister, author, and eligible bachelor, did not see his Clementine again after their first awkward meeting for another 4 years, until they met by chance at a dinner party. A few weeks later, at Churchill's request, she was invited with him to Blenheim Palace to spend the weekend as a guest of Churchill's cousin, the Duke of Marlborough. Churchill had decided that he wanted to marry Clementine, and that Blenheim Palace, his birthplace and the home of his ancestors, was the right place to propose. The weekend was almost over, however, and Churchill had not found the courage to say anything.
And at this point, Winston's cousin, the Duke, who'd been observing all this, took things into his own hands. My mother came down to breakfast quite early. She was an early riser. And the Duke went upstairs. My father was in bed reading the newspapers, I imagine. And he gave him a piece of his mind. I imagine it was to the effect that if you want to marry this beautiful girl, you better get out of bed, get dressed, go down there and propose to her.
It was on the 11th of August, 1908, that Churchill finally plucked up courage to invite Clementine Hosier to walk with him in the grounds at Blenheim Palace. While they were walking, it came on to rain. So they took shelter here in the Temple of Diana. And while inside the temple, Churchill nervously asked her to marry him. She accepted. They decided to keep the news of their engagement secret until she could go to London and tell her mother. But as they emerged from the temple, Churchill suddenly saw his closest friend, rushed up to him, embraced him, and in full sight of several palace servants, blurted out the news. So the secret was out.
A month later, they were married at St. Margaret's Westminster. She was 23. He was 10 years older. In January 1911, three policemen were killed by armed burglars, who were then trapped in Sydney Street in the East End of London. Now Home Secretary, Churchill arrived to take personal charge of what seemed like a military operation in a London street.
And I could see a man with a tall top hat and a long black coat standing there. I didn't know who he was. I was 9 years old at the time. I didn't know who he was, but he was standing there surrounded by people. But it wasn't until after the siege, and the papers were full of it, we realised who he was that had been standing across the road there.
A company of Scots Guards and horse artillery were brought in. Churchill was to be much criticised by press, Parliament and the public for risking his own life and conducting operations there as Home Secretary. After a 10-hour siege, the house caught fire and the burglars died in the burning building. Churchill had greater problems with the suffragettes. He supported the view of the Liberal government that women did not need the vote, but as Home Secretary, the issue for him was not so much votes, but the maintenance of law and order. The worst incident between police and suffragettes was a running 6-hour battle in Parliament Square. Churchill was blamed by the suffragettes for their harsh treatment by the police.
When he was questioned about it, first he said that the police had misunderstood his instructions. Later, a week later, he told the House of Commons that no instructions had been given, either verbal or in writing. Indeed, there was a complete cover-up. My mother always felt that Churchill was an ambitious politician whose behaviour was less than honest.
Churchill became hated by the suffragettes. After he had opposed them in the House of Commons, he was physically attacked.
On one occasion, one of them tried to throw my father under a train which was arriving at the station and was fended off by my mother, who hit her hard with an umbrella.
Churchill warned the cabinet that if they gave the vote to women, they would perish at a woman's hand.
My father was not in favour of votes for women, not till very much later, with a good deal of candour, he remarked that he would have been more in favour of them having the vote when he realised how many of them subsequently voted for him.
In 1911, Churchill was finally given the cabinet post that most suited his love of military affairs, First Lord of the Admiralty. "It was my golden age," he later wrote. He fought his corner hard to ensure that the Royal Navy would be strong enough to deter the growing menace of the German fleet. In the summer of 1914, people's thoughts were far from war. Churchill was prepared.
"Everything tends towards catastrophe and collapse. I am interested, geared up and happy. Is it not horrible to be built like that? The preparations have a hideous fascination for me." Which everyone believed would be over by Christmas became a bloody stalemate on the Western Front. To break the deadlock, Churchill proposed a naval attack through the Dardanelles against Germany's ally Turkey to his colleague Lloyd George.
"Winston said to Elgin, 'If I can force the Dardanelles by the British Navy, I shall be the greatest man in Europe.' Lloyd George was in favour of it, provided always that it was a combined operation with Kitchener at the War Office and the Navy. Winston was impetuous and wanted it to be alone."
To Churchill and his admirals, it seemed almost a simple plan to send British warships through this narrow strip of water to Constantinople and victory over the Turks. For the British admirals and for Churchill, the firepower of the British battleships seemed sufficient first to blast and then to push past the Turkish forts. The British cabinet in London were excited by the prospect of a series of magnificent victories which would follow this single naval success.
Kitchener was unwilling to send troops to Turkey immediately. Churchill persuaded the cabinet that the navy should go it alone. When the British and French launched their assault on the Dardanelles, bombarding the Turkish forts, 6 Allied ships were sunk or disabled by hidden mines. The British admiral in command called off the attack. Churchill urged a renewed assault, but the cabinet had lost faith in his judgment that the navy alone would succeed. In May 1915, he was removed from the admiralty. Kitchener poured troops into the Dardanelles, but after 6 months and the death of more than 100,000 men, the British withdrew. Churchill was blamed for this costly and bloody campaign. Not only had his naval attack failed, many believed it had only served to warn the Turks of British intentions.
There's no doubt that Churchill's attempt in January was in effect sending the Turks a postcard that we're coming along in some weeks' time. He wanted something done yesterday that should have been where he should have waited. Impatience, impulsiveness. It was a very good idea, but a king-sized cock-up. And a lot of lives wasted in a useless endeavour.
My mother thought that the Dardanelles marked the absolute nadir of his political fortunes, and that it had a deep effect upon him. And she said, "I thought he would die of grief."
Cold-shouldered by his colleagues, Churchill decided to fight as a soldier on the Western Front. On the day of his departure, Clementine wrote,
"There was a thick fog, and the figure was misty and dim. I feel you receding into the fog and mud of Flanders, and not coming back for so long."
The ex-cabinet minister was now Lieutenant Colonel, commanding the 6th Battalion, Royal Scots Fusiliers. The disaster of the Dardanelles made him less than welcome at the front.
Everybody was saying, "Why does Winston Churchill, our cabinet minister, not go to some other battalion? We don't want him here. We've got a good commanding officer here." Well, the mere fact that he came back with the shadow of the Dardanelles over him, they had a very poor opinion of him.
Churchill established his headquarters in this farm in Belgium, at a little village called Ploegsteert, Plug Street to the soldiers, only a few hundred yards behind the front line. He was not afraid of sharing danger with his men, and would often go on patrol close to the German lines.
I took Winston Churchill up over the top of the parapet into no man's land, and whenever we got to a certain hole in front of the German barbed wire, we would crawl into it, and we'd lie there up to here in water, listening to the Germans talking, and I heard them stamping their feet on the duckboards to warm their feet.
Churchill's men quickly grew to like him. He shared their hardships and their moments of relaxation.
Winston Churchill was the world's most horrible singer, and he started to sing "My Old Tarpaulin Jacket," and it was terrible. And the boys, they would clap him, and they were as pleased as could be. He was a real man.
"Wrap me up in me tarpaulin jacket, and say a poor buffer lies low. Get 6 stalwart lances to carry me, with steps mournful, solemn and slow."
Churchill became depressed and angry at the slaughter. Clementine was his one comfort.
"My dearest one, I have your little photograph up to my lips now, and I kiss it each night before I go to bed. What should I do if I had not you to write to when I am despondent?"
After 6 months in France, Churchill had returned to Britain. He spent a further year in the political wilderness until his friend Lloyd George, now Prime Minister, brought him back to the cabinet, despite Conservative opposition. In 1919, as Secretary of State for War, he was plunged into the problems of Ireland. In their fight for an independent Ireland, the newly formed IRA were attacking the British Army. Outraged by IRA atrocities, Churchill sent in a volunteer regiment, the Black and Tans, to crush the rebellion. The Black and Tans were notorious for their cruelty.
They used to resort to methods like indiscriminate firing from lorries, shooting children, trailing men, captured men behind them, so the bits of them were found all over the roadway after the lorries had passed. They burnt villages, they burnt homes, they burnt towns.
They committed atrocities against the Irish people. They were inclined to take out all their frustrations on the ordinary people. And the Irish people held Churchill responsible for that.
In Britain too, Churchill was criticised for the government's harsh measures. Even Clementine reproached him.
"It always makes me unhappy and disappointed when I see you inclined to take for granted that the rough, iron-fisted, Hunnish way will prevail."
Churchill soon realised that force was not working. A political agreement would have to be negotiated. Michael Collins, military leader of the IRA, came to London to discuss an Anglo-Irish treaty. Churchill took a firm line.
"In the final days of the negotiating of the treaty, that there was absolutely no doubt in Collins' mind, and in other members of the negotiating team, that Churchill threatened an all-out war.
And Churchill was using phrases like real war, not mere bushranging. We'll drive, and that implied concentration camps, it implied aerial bombardment, and the full rigour of the British Army."
So the Irish Treaty was signed, and Collins posed with King and Cabinet. The treaty made Southern Ireland the Irish Free State. It excluded Ulster, the predominantly Protestant counties of the north, which remained part of the United Kingdom. Collins wrote gratefully to Churchill, "We couldn't have done it without you," and British troops left Ireland. But the treaty was rejected by many Irish Republicans. Within 6 months, Collins was assassinated. Ireland sank into civil war. In 1924, the Conservatives won the election. Baldwin, the new Prime Minister, invited Churchill to rejoin the government. He was now to change parties a second time, from Liberal back to Conservative.
He had many, many enemies in the ranks of the Conservative Party who refused to accept that Churchill could be trusted in any way. And he was utterly amazed, and as he put it, the Conservative Party dumbfounded when Mr. Baldwin invited him to become Chancellor of the Exchequer. He used to say, of course, anyone can rat, but it takes talent to re-rat.
Don't go down in the mine, Dad. Dreams very often come true. Daddy, you know it would break my heart if anything happened to you.
A crisis had arisen in the coal industry. The mine owners were demanding an immediate cut in wages. The miners refused and were locked out by the owners.
The 26th strike was about half an hour on the day and 10% off the pay. And the miners' leader of the day, A.J. Cook, famous saying was not a minute on the day, not a penny off the pay.
To support the miners, the trade unions called a general strike. The government called in volunteers to run the transport system and to help break the strike. To Churchill and the government, a halt to all work posed the threat of anarchy.
Churchill was Chancellor of the Exchequer. 25 years earlier, he had been a journalist. Now the cabinet asked him to take charge of a government news sheet, but he decided to go one better and to produce a newspaper. He did so. It was called the British Gazette, and within a week had reached the incredible circulation of 3 million copies. Churchill and his newspaper were outspoken. If the general strike were to succeed, he said, the trade union leaders would become masters of the nation. Either the country will succeed in breaking the general strike, or the general strike will break the country.
Well, of course, Churchill blamed the miners for the strike. He thought it was the hotheads that had got to work, and ignoring altogether the demands that had been made on them by the coal owners. And well, as far as Churchill was concerned, he didn't care tuppence for any of the working class. He'd never experienced the conditions that they lived under, and he'd no idea what they was like.
Without pay, many mining families were on the verge of starvation.
My personal opinions about Churchill was, say, there was a lot more people. I'm not a vindictive person, but at that time I thought that him and Baldwin, for that matter, would have been better dead, because the country would have been a better place.
Churchill believed the general strike would have to be broken before a settlement could be reached. He advised the Prime Minister, tonight surrender, tomorrow magnanimity.
Churchill's whole attitude to life, you know, was to beat you down, and then, after you'd conceded, tired, weak, nothing to offer, he'd want to talk to you.
This is London calling the British Isles. We have just received the news that the general strike has been called off by the leaders of the Trade Union Council.
Churchill, as editor of the British Gazette, was thought by the miners to be the villain of the piece.
I wrote a letter to Churchill as Chancellor of the Exchequer, and I said I was very sorry, but I couldn't see the miners being left to struggle on and ultimately conquered by starvation and cold. And Churchill wrote me a long letter back and said, come and see me, and I'd like to talk to you about this. So I did, and it's the first time I'd ever met Churchill. And I went into his room at the Treasury, And he said, I understand your pangs and anxieties. And he said, as a matter of fact, I'm on your side. I can't say so as a member of the cabinet, but I wanted to give them a very generous settlement, and I got within sight of it. But I wasn't allowed to by the cabinet.
Churchill remained Chancellor for 5 years. He introduced pension for widows and orphans, and reduced taxes for the poor. Lloyd George called him the merriest tax collector since Robin Hood. But he failed to revive the economy or to reduce unemployment as he had hoped.
He was a complete fish out of water, Churchill, at the Treasury. And he'd come out of a conference of high experts and economists and bankers, which he loathed. And I said, what happened? And he looked at me rather sadly and he said, you know, after it, I wish these fellows were admirals or generals. I talk their language and I can make them understand what I say and often make them do what I want. But after a time, these bankers and economists start talking Persian, and then I'm sunk.
Ramsay MacDonald led Labour to victory in the 1929 general election. 2 years later, MacDonald formed a national government with Conservatives and Liberals, but there was no place for Churchill. He was disliked by the Tories, particularly because he opposed their plans to give self-government to India, in his view, still the foundation of British imperial power. Outspoken, controversial, always the outsider, he seemed now to have no political future. A humble backbencher, he was to be out of office for 10 years. Churchill had lost a small fortune in the Wall Street crash. Now he came to the States, in the grip of the Depression, to earn money by lecturing.
I'm going to talk about this economic problem, which ought to cause us all continuous thought. It is surely a great mystery that we should all be so much poorer now than we were 2 or 3 years ago. Why should the whole world suddenly have got so much poorer?
These attempts to offer a solution to the economic problems were unexpectedly interrupted.
Churchill had been invited to a house on Fifth Avenue to meet some friends. His taxi searched for an hour in vain to find the house. Agitated, Churchill got out of the taxi and began to walk. Being English, he looked the wrong way. Suddenly, he was struck by a car, falling to the ground and lying here in the street. He was badly hurt, bleeding both from the head and from the legs.
Churchill spent a week in hospital. I certainly suffered every pang, mental and physical, he wrote, but there is neither the time nor the strength for self-pity. Live dangerously. Dread naught. All will be well.
After a few days, he sat up in bed, and he dictated a really quite wonderful article on how it feels to be knocked down by a car. He sold it for a much-needed $5,000.
I had a hard bump. Harder bump, I think, than most people would like to take. However, here I am, and I hope I'm going to have better luck this time. I feel very much better.
Bound for a well-earned rest in the Bahamas, Winston Churchill cheerfully faces the demon cameramen on leaving his hotel.
That's the stuff to give him.
Mr. Churchill, great British statesman, is almost fully recovered from his encounter with a New York taxicab.
Churchill continued his lecture tour. His new secretary came to know him better.
But he was really the most unselfconscious person I've ever met. He never seemed to care what anyone else thought of him. I can remember one instance of that. He was undressing for dinner, and meanwhile, of course, dictating to me. I watched with some apprehension as he shed first his coat and his tie, his collar, and then he began to loosen his braces, which held his trousers up. Well, I realized that he was absolutely wrapped up and while he was dictating, and really didn't even know I was there. But when it came to really letting his trousers down, I rose to my feet and I said very firmly, "Mr. Churchill." And I saw a startled look come over his face, and he pulled his trousers up and he said, "Oh dear, I do apologize, but you know, don't you, that when I've got an idea in my mind, I simply am not aware of anything that's going on around me." I very soon realized that as a secretary I was no more to him than a fountain pen that required no time to eat or time to rest. I was on the go perpetually. Often I wouldn't have time to eat, and I'd suddenly, late in the afternoon, realize that I needed some food. So I'd snatch a cup of coffee and a sandwich and then go on, sometimes till 2 or 3 in the morning. He was a terribly inconsiderate man. In fact, I've never known anyone who was so inconsiderate. And it wasn't that he was cruel, but he was so involved in his own wishes, his own desires to get the work done, that he never thought about the person who had to do it.
Chartwell in Kent was the family home for Clementine and their 4 children. Churchill had bought it on impulse, against the wishes of his wife.
She thought she'd talked him out of it. But while my mother was in bed, recovering from my birth, he swept the other 3 children up and brought them all down here for a day expedition. And of course, they fell in love with it too. And then he said to them, "Well, isn't it wonderful, because I've just bought it."
She was afraid of what it was all going to cost, this large house with 82 acres, which would all need upkeep. The house would need 14 servants at least, which would need upkeep. It was a constant worry to her. He would say, "Oh, don't worry about trifles, it's all right," and dismiss it easily.
He always used to say, "A day spent away from Chartwell is a day wasted." He wrote here, he worked here, he played here. I mean, he made those lakes. He made the dam there in the distance and made first one lake and then 2 lakes, and then he built the swimming pool. And then he started building walls, and that red brick wall was built very largely by him.
Clementine was the perfect wife to deal with Churchill's restless energy.
I was always astonished what a good marriage it was, in spite of the fact that he was a terribly demanding man. It seemed to me that Clemmy had worked out a way of managing him. He always rushed off to her with any new idea he had and to ask her opinion. And she never hesitated to say if she liked it or if she didn't. And very often they'd have a rather heated argument about it. And he afterwards would say, "You know, she's my pussycat. She spits at me."
Well, they always wrote to each other. You know, it was the era of, though under the same roof, would write notes or letters once or twice a day. And she would, if she thought he'd been something at a dinner table she did not approve of, she would write him a little note and make him aware of it.
They never shared a bedroom. They had quite separate rooms, and it was explained to me that Mrs. Churchill liked to go to bed fairly early, whereas he would stay up till 3 o'clock in the morning. Churchill only shared her room when he got a written invitation.
From Chartwell, working with a team of researchers, Churchill wrote at this desk his 4-volume biography of his ancestor, John Churchill, Duke of Marlborough. The book was to earn him over £500,000. He also began his epic history of the English-speaking peoples.
I've written a very great many books.
I think by the time I was 25 years old, I'd written as many books as Moses.
Churchill needed to earn large sums of money to support the lifestyle he and his family expected.
His daughter, Diana, came in one morning with a handful of bills, and she said, "Look at these wretched things. They've been following me about for a year. You know, I can't possibly pay them." I said, looking at them and noticing how many famous stores, the names were on these bills, I said, "Well, how on earth did you run these bills up?" "Oh," she said, "you know, if you're a Churchill, you can always get credit. Why, Randolph bought a Rolls Royce on credit. He drove it home, and Papa saw it. He said, 'You take that right back.' And he made him do it."
Churchill loved the sun. He loved the water. Here in the south of France, where so many of his close personal friends had villas, he came two or three times a year, not only to write and paint, but also to ponder the international situation and the whole troubled future of Europe.
In 1933, Hitler became Chancellor of Germany. While the rest of Europe was disarming, the Nazis were rearming fast. In 1936, Hitler remilitarized the Rhineland, where no German troops were allowed. Britain took no action. At Chartwell, Churchill received secret information about Germany's future intentions. One informant was a friend in the Foreign Office.
But there was a very highly paid official who fed him accurate information, and which, of course, was contrary to what was strictly proper. But it was, in fact, the case that Winston was in the possession of very much more accurate information than was available to the public.
Churchill made use of this secret information to urge Britain to rearm, but the government was for appeasement, and few took him or his warnings seriously.
Well, I'm afraid I was one of those foolish people who agreed with the writing off. And I used to see him in the old Carlton Club. In that club, you went in through a great big hall where people sat having drinks and so on for lunch or dinner. And he would be sitting there before lunch having a drink with his friends, happy, cheerful. But I thought, well, what a pity. Yes, this man with his tremendous qualities, his great past. Nothing whatever to do except sit having drinks in the Carlton Club before lunch. No, it was all very sad.
Of those elder statesmen, whose ranks, quite a number of persons are anxious to promote me.
Churchill himself began to believe that his political career was finished.
Ultimately, if I'm good.
He'd come up to Oxford to speak in support of my professor, his friend, Professor Lindemann, who was at that time trying to get into Parliament. And the prof brought him into the lab on the Saturday morning and wanted to show him what I was doing in the way of trying to detect aeroplanes. And, well, he seemed at that stage so tired, looked rather florid and so forth. When he went out, we saw poor old Winston, he can't last much longer.
I said to my companions, I said, is that Churchill, Winston Churchill? And they said, yes, 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 it is. That's him. I said, oh, I wonder if I dare go over and introduce myself. I have some letters that I've been asked to deliver by hand to him, and I don't really know him like I did the younger generation, but I wonder if I dare. And they said, oh, yes, yes, oh, of course, he's a nice, easygoing old boy. You know, he's had every job in the cabinet. He's done everything, a wonderful old history, but he's now washed up. There's no future, so he's now a party of one in the House of Commons, and so he's interesting with memories, but you'll find him a nice old bird to talk to. And that was just 2 years before the war broke out, and his greatest future was ahead of him.
In March 1938, Hitler annexed Austria. At Munich 7 months later, the British and French gave in to his demands for part of Czechoslovakia.
Here is the paper which bears his name upon it, as well as mine.
Neville Chamberlain, Britain's Prime Minister, promised peace for our time.
Chamberlain always thought that Winston was prejudicing the possibility of a peace. He found him a real obstacle to his policy. And that view was shared not only by Chamberlain and Baldwin, but by most of the cabinet at that time.
Once again, the rattle of a German army on the march echoes in Europe.
In March 1939, Hitler broke the Munich Agreement and occupied the Czech capital, Prague. Churchill, denounced by many of the appeasers as a warmonger, was proved right.
We must ask, is this a call to war? Does anyone pretend that preparations for resistance against aggression amount to the unleashing of war? I declare it to be the sole guarantee of peace.
One always had the sense that he was waiting in the wings. He invited me to lunch at the Savoy and simply asked me whether I thought the youth of England were ready for war against Hitler, and even knew it was coming.
One man who shared and promoted Churchill's views was Stefan Laurent, editor of Picture Post. He interviewed Churchill on a memorable visit to Chartwell.
And so we had lunch, and I remember it was steak and kidney pie. And I didn't like steak and kidney pie, but I took a little bit. But Mr. Churchill had a steak and kidney pie in a bowl. And instead of taking the spoon, and as I did, he took the bowl to his mouth, and he took the spoon and shoveled the steak and kidney pie in. And I was just looking, you know, at him, what he was doing. Then he had the cigar there at the table, at the ashtray. So he took the cigar, he puffed a couple of things, put it back, shoveled again. Then he had a little glass, not a little, quite a big glass of brandy. So he drank a little brandy, and then I looked at him. I didn't believe it. There was a piece of chocolate, and while he shoveled the steak and kidney pie, he stopped for a second and put a chocolate in his mouth. And I said, I don't believe it. There's no such a thing.
Picture Post was to carry several articles on Churchill. One of them stated, his greatest moment is still to come. A nationwide campaign began to bring Churchill back. People realized he was the one man prepared to resist the growing menace of Hitler.
Military weakness in this country encourages potential enemies. Anyone can see that public opinion is growing in favor of compulsory national service in all its forms, and especially in the highest form.
On the 1st of September 1939, Hitler invaded Poland. Britain and France declared war on Germany.
It is only after many vain attempts to remain at peace that we have been at last forced to go to war. We tried again and again to prevent this war. And for the sake of peace, we put up with a lot of things happening which ought not to have happened. But now we are at war. And we are going to make war and persevere in making war until the other side has had enough of it.
Chamberlain now asked Churchill to join the War Cabinet as First Lord of the Admiralty. That morning, Churchill told the Commons, "We are fighting to save the whole world from the pestilence of Nazi tyranny." That same evening, the Admiralty signaled to the fleet, "Winston is back."
The First Lord sees the machines and the men and the way they live. And so far as the men are concerned, there's welcome written all over their faces.
True to character, Mr. Churchill rings the changes on his headgear and, inspecting an RAF unit, appears in a cap of the Royal Yacht Squadron.
Mr. Churchill likes to know. Mr. Churchill's inspection is no cursory affair. And as he passes down the ranks of ratings and civilian workers, they are glad to be there.
He was underemployed because he had such an active mind and worked so hard and long that he really hadn't got enough to do with simply the Admiralty business. And he kept on interfering in the affairs of the other service ministers or the Minister of Supply or anybody. Rather annoyed some of them, I think.
Churchill's frustrations grew. It was the period of the phony war when the only action was taking place at sea. But naval news was often bad, with the frequent loss of British ships and men. In April 1940, German troops occupied Denmark and southern Norway. Seeing the chance of forestalling the Germans, Churchill had long wanted the fleet sent to Norway. But the cabinet had delayed too long, and the Germans got there first. For 3 weeks, the British struggled in vain to drive them out. The battle for Norway was a disaster, for which some blamed Churchill. Many Conservative MPs, however, had decided that it was Chamberlain who had to go, and that Churchill, now seen as the watchdog of Britain's security, should replace him. In the Commons, 80 Conservative MPs voted against the government. A coalition with Labour was inevitable. But the Labour leaders, Attlee and Greenwood, said Labour would not serve in any government led by Chamberlain.
Goodbye, Mr. Chamberlain, and thanks for all you've tried to do.
On the 10th of May 1940, Chamberlain resigned. The question was, who would succeed him? Would it be Winston Churchill, whose voice from the wilderness had for years predicted the menace of Hitler? Or Lord Halifax, a leading advocate of appeasement who was supported by the majority of Conservatives?
Why get rid of Chamberlain to put in Halifax? It's like getting rid of the organ grinder to put in the monkey. So Labour made it clear. It was Labour who, as the Tory backbencher said, must speak for England, and they spoke for England by saying that Churchill was a man they would support now.
He was a good fighting man, and this is a time when you wanted your leaders fighting people, not politicians, whatever their views, and they were solidly behind him.
There was only one person who could hold the country together in what was coming to us and what did come to us within a matter of days.
On the evening of the 10th of May, Churchill became Prime Minister. It was, he later wrote, as if I were walking with destiny and that all my past life had been but a preparation for this hour. But he warned that hard times lay ahead.
I have nothing to offer but blood, toil, tears, and sweat. We have before us an ordeal of the most grievous kind. We have before us many, many long months of struggle and of suffering. You ask, what is our policy? I will say, it is to wage war by sea, land, and air, with all our might and with all the strength that God can give us, to wage war against a monstrous tyranny never surpassed in the dark and lamentable catalogue of human crime. That is our policy.
Next week, part two tells the story of Churchill at war, from the crisis at Dunkirk to the great victory at Alamein. That's next Wednesday at the same time.